Well, thank you all for coming tonight. I'd like to say up front on the Daedalus Journal, it is the most provocative, informative journal on the U.S. military that I've read. This particular volume in 38 years now of previous military and government service, I commend it to all of you. In fact, I'm going to send a note to our chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Marty Dempsey, and ask that he consider making it mandatory reading for our officer corps. It's superb. Three very quick points, because I know everyone here is interested in getting on with the conversation. I'd like to talk briefly about this theme of the risk of alienation of our armed forces from greater society. Secondly, the threat that comes with our declining economic and fiscal standing in the world today, and the threat that that poses to our national security structure and to our military. And third, perhaps a plea for civilian leadership, for our civilian leadership, to better conceptualize in the years ahead our national security strategy, and perhaps to give more thought to the direction of major military operations. First, with regard to the potential decoupling, the Time magazine article that Professor Kennedy mentioned by Mark Thompson, I would also commend that to you, the 21 November article, quite good. Most people, when they talk about the potential decoupling of American, the military from our society, they trace this back potentially to the end of the beginning of the all-volunteer force in 1973. I'm embarrassed to say my military career spans the draft army and the military force. I was a cadet at West Point in 1969. Let me make clear to you, at that period of time, we had an ill-disciplined draft army. It was ridden with racial problems. It was ridden with drugs. In fact, in 1971, as a acting platoon leader, I went to the 25th Infantry Division, Schofield Barracks, Hawaii. 25th Infantry Division just recently returned from Vietnam. On a Saturday, I had the responsibility to be what's called the staff duty officer, check on the barracks to make sure good order and discipline is being maintained. I was told that Saturday afternoon as I was getting ready to go on duty, you will carry this revolver and you will have this live ammunition with you, because when you go into the barracks on Saturday night, you don't know what to expect. So be careful about romanticizing the draft army is the point, if it needed to be made. On the other hand, then, that begs the question, no draft army, all volunteer force, what are the consequences of that? Raise your hand if you think that we would have invaded Iraq had we had a draft army, and the condition is the draft army is capable of performing the mission. Raise your hand if you think we would have invaded Iraq with a draft army. Raise your hand if you think that we would have today 100,000 troops in Afghanistan, American troops in Afghanistan, 10 years after 9/11. Raise your hand if we had a draft army. What was the point? The point was that the constraint on our government in the Vietnam War came, political constraint, came in part from the draft army. It was unpopular. Given a Congress that hasn't been very clear over many decades about how it exercises its function to declare war and has been very ambiguous and generally has not exercise that prerogative, the last time it did was World War II, then you do have to think about this, because if your answer to the question is we may not have gone into to Iraq, or we certainly, the campaign over time would have looked differently, or we wouldn't be in Afghanistan at 100,000, if your answer is certainly not, then you have to ask yourself the question, is there something wrong with the Republic right now? It's a fundamental question of values and accountability, and I think that there is. The question about then what do you do with it? Well, a return to the draft. Marty Dempsey in his confirmation hearing at the United States Senate this summer said, and I agree, that a return to the draft would certainly come at a huge cost to the readiness of our armed forces. Politically, probably not is a non-starter. So how do you proceed? Dr. Perry had some very good insights. I thought perhaps during the conversation that follows, we want to talk about this more. Second point is on our declining economic standing, the impact on the armed forces, and our comprehensive security strategy. First of all, the American way of war is materially and it's very technically intensive. The American military, it dominates battlefields, it dominates theaters of war. by being very savvy with using high-quality material and having the technological edge, with the American creativity and genius being how do you take all of this sophisticated equipment and employ it in very clever ways. I believe that as we have been materially technologically dependent over the last two centuries, we will be even more so in the years ahead. This gets back into the question then of ensuring that our defense base, our related civilian industrial base, our technological base remains in advance of our potential contenders. There, in that Daedalus set of articles, there's also a very good article about the potential vulnerability that our military faces with peer competitors or just clever competitors being able to figure out how to deny us the tremendous advantage that we enjoy right now in terms of precision strike, related ISR, intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance system, command and control. I would commend that to you as well. But beyond this, beyond the military implications of a weakening economy and our weakening fiscal strength, there also is the broader question of what does this mean then for our ability to deliver as a nation comprehensive national security strategy. Several points here. First of all, recent trip that my wife and I made to Australia, a good chance to meet with leaders in and out of power in Australia. I heard the term for the first time, a half of superpower, talking about the United States of America, that we, the United States, unrivaled, unmatched in terms of defense capabilities, but they continued to talk over time about how their trade patterns were changing dramatically. China, East Asia, Southeast Asia, South Asia. I read a pundit had written recently that power follows the flow of money, and right now there's a lot of dollars flowing out of the United States of America. At what point in time does a case like Australia, they start to recalculate? Eisenhower has been mentioned several times here tonight. Eisenhower, in his always very eloquent way, once wrote, there's no defense for any country that busts its own economy. And I think that that's a good note of advice. Third and finally, the need for our civilian leadership to better articulate our national security strategy and to provide more coherent guidance on its implementation. I don't believe that we will, in the course of the political ensuing campaign, as you had pointed out, Jim, it's just not on the radar scope of the American people. I saw yesterday that in Iowa, Republicans canvassed what's important to you. 0%, that's none, had national security, international security as important as they approached the caucus. So it's probably going to fall upon an administration, Obama II or a Republican administration, then to subsequently, after taking office, if they wish, to redefine our national security strategy in the post, in light of the last 10 years and the war on terror. The last point I'll make, and aware of the red light here, is that the point of our civilian leaders needing, when we have major military operations, to grip these more. Our militaries, they wage military campaigns. Our civilian leaderships is responsible for directing and providing guidance. We've had quotes from George Washington. I'll go a couple of centuries earlier to a very famous Chinese military strategist commenting on Sun Tzu. His name was Li Chuan, who said, war is a grave matter. One is apprehensive lest men embark upon it without due reflections. And so as I listen on the campaign trail right now to various candidates being asked, and candidate, what would you do in Afghanistan? And the answer comes, I would listen to my generals and give them what they want. I get worried when we hear answers like that. Bill, thank you.